Coming today through this weather, it is just incredible outside right now. I guess you might have missed the worst of it. Now, I don't know how many of you have seen the book from Malgudi, which is an imaginary place, to Makondo, which is another imaginary place, as he will tell you. But it's an amazing book. And the best part is the chapter on football. And how he got tricked into supporting Boca Juniors. You know, I was sent to Manchester to study so I could back Manchester United, you know, for the last 50 years. So it's a bit like that. But Mr. Viswanathan, Ambassador Viswanathan, is just an amazing man. And his love affair, which became a marriage to Latin America. So he practices this is legally not allowed. He has two wives, one who's sitting here in the front row, Mrs. Viswanathan, and the other is Latin America. Okay. And he's got some of his former colleagues from the Ministry of External Affairs here to give his approval for what he's been doing. But this is a great story. He'd tell us something about it. And if you go to his website and read his bio about how he used to walk miles to go to school, how he managed to persuade his elders to allow him to go to college, it's just a fascinating story. And one of these days, ministry permitting, you might actually be heading back that way to Latin America, where he wants to live and where he wants to work. So he's continues to be a lifetime ambassador for us to Latin America. I don't know whether some of your colleagues, former colleagues, will approve of that, because you'll be hanging around there creating a nuisance. But it's great that you will. And are you going to talk about golf also? Yes. I met a gentleman from Argentina in New York. We were in the same meeting. And I said, you know, I have a friend of mine who's ambassador in Argentina. He said, oh, the golfing ambassador. That's your reputation. Didn't do any serious work there. Basically enjoyed himself. So just listen to him. Enjoy yourself, because I think he's enjoying himself. And this is a wonderful title, The Journey of an Innocent Indian Who Eats Beef, by the way. Only Latin American beef, because there are no holy cows in Latin America. The holy cows are only in India. You notice that I have read some parts of your book. And so over to you. Come. Ambassador Viswanathan.
Good evening. A wet and wild evening to talk about the hot and steamy Latin America.
You tell them the story of the 72-year-old
and the 27-year-old. My Latin American journey started in Brazil in 1996. I was 44 years old, and I was still innocent. I was swept off my feet by the samba culture of Brazil. I was so excited. I wanted to write a book then itself about Latin America. But my Brazilian friends advised me against it. They said, don't be foolish. Don't waste this age in writing books. This is the age for action and to gather experience. They said you should write after the age of 60. And they explained it with their story in a typical Brazilian way. They said, men are like birds. Between the age of 20 and 30, they are like crows. They eat anything and everything. Between the age of 40 and 60, they are like eagles. They choose what they eat. Between the age of 60 and 80, they are like parrots. They talk more than they eat. And above 80, they are like condor up there in the hills. But in Portuguese, it means, com means with, dor means pain. Condor aqui, pain here, pain there. I ended my Latin American journey on 31st of May this year in Buenos Aires. I was 60 years old, and I was no longer innocent. But my Argentine friends gave me an advice. They said, don't stop having fun when you are old. You become old only when you stop having fun. So my message to my like-minded friends who are inclined to travel is that you should visit Latin America. You should make your own journeys to Latin America, and you will come back happier and younger. Now, this is not just my theory. I have evidence, historical evidence. In 1924, there was an Indian who made a journey to Latin America. An Indian, not so innocent, but illustrious Indian, reached Buenos Aires on 6th November 1924. He was 63 years old. He stayed in Buenos Aires for 2 months till 3rd January 1925. And he was rejuvenated. He felt like a 34-year-old. The secret was 34 years old, an Argentine beauty, Victoria Ocampo. And the illustrious Indian is Rabindranath Tagore. He wrote many letters to her, dozens of letters. In one of the letters, he said, we were of unequal age, but I was not aware of the difference. He wrote a series of poems on her, calling her as Victoria, calling her as Dear Vijaya, my Balobasa. Balobasa, is that correct? Dear Victoria, my Balobasa. This bunch of poems is called Purabi. In one of the poems, he writes, oh, exotic blossom, I asked, what is your language, dear? You smiled and shook your head, and the leaves murmured instead. One day, Victoria Ocampo saw Tagore trying to sketch something. And she said, dear Gurudev, you have talent for painting. You must start painting. So Tagore looked up to her and said, really? And she gave a deal. She said, you make painting seriously. I will organize the exhibition of your paintings. And she did in 1930 in Paris. With her own money and with her own contacts, she organized Tagore's painting exhibitions. So when old people go to Latin America, they come back happier and younger and write books and poems. So what do the young people do? They don't waste their time. There is a chapter in my book. It's called as The Risk of Doing business with Latin America, the risk of doing business with Colombia is falling in love. There are these three Indian guys, youngsters, they went to do IT project for MySys in Bogota. Promptly, they fell in love with three Colombian girls. Married, settled there, and they started their own company called Sofo Solutions, which is doing extremely well in IT. My journey to Latin America started from Malgudi. As you know, Malgudi is the fictional small town in the novels of R.K. Narayan. The Malgudians are stereotyped as people who are innocent, simple, religious, conservative, traditional, and very serious. They are so serious that if you have to make a Malgudian laugh on a Friday, you have to tell them a joke on Monday. They would need 5 days to process it, understand, analyze, reflect, and then decide to laugh. Now, Macondo is the fictional town in the novels of Gabriel Garcia Marquez, the Colombian Nobel Prize winner. The stereotype of characters in Macondo are magical realism. Now, you want to know what is magical realism? I asked a Venezuelan guy once, "Amigo, are you married?" He looked at me with a mischievous smile and said, "Más o menos," which means more or less. I didn't understand whether he was more married or more than married, less than married. In my journey from Malgudi to Macondo, I imbibed the spirit of Latin America and discovered a new Latin America politically and economically. This Latin American spirit, to me, is illustrated in this pop song from Argentina, my favorite Argentine pop singer called Axel Fernando. It's called Celebra la Vida, celebrate life. The song goes like this: Celebra la vida, segundo a segundo, nada se guarda, todo se brinda. Celebrate life from second to second. Don't hold anything. Give out everything. That is the spirit of Latin America. Now, I will illustrate this Latin American spirit with three stories: a literary story, a filmy story, and a real life story. The literary story is in a novel called Aunt Julia and the Scriptwriter by Mario Vargas Llosa from Peru, who won the Nobel Prize. In this novel, the hero is an 18-year-old boy. One day, his aunt lands up from Bolivia in his house, where he lives with his parents. And this Bolivian aunt has become a widow at the age of 36. So she comes and stays with this hero's parents. So the parents of this boy tell him, "Son, this poor aunt is very sad and depressed. Why don't you take her out, take her to theaters, films, and cheer her up?" And he tries to do that reluctantly. And the aunt treats him like all the aunts, treats him like a kid. And it frustrates him even more. But then he perseveres and takes her out every day. And in the course of doing that, the inevitable happens. He falls in love with her and declares his love. But the aunt doesn't believe. She says, "Kid, this is just infatuation. It will go away tomorrow when you meet other young girls." But he pursues, continues, and then one day declares, says that, "I want to marry you." She laughs at him and says, "What? You want to marry me? 18-year-old boy married to a 36-year-old woman? You'll be the laughing stock?" You won't survive. And you would leave me at the sight of the first young girl. But he persists. Finally, one day she faces him and says, "Hey, you say that you are in real love with me and you want to marry me. Suppose we marry. How long do you think you will stay with me and we will live happily together?" This young boy of 18 years old, he doesn't think. He just says, 2 years. The aunt says, 2 years? Fantastic. It's worthwhile. Let's get married. And they marry. That is the Latin American spirit. If the marriage is worth for 2 years, yes, let's marry. There is the other story, filmy story. There is a film, Colombian film, called Embajador de la India. It means the ambassador of India, the real name. In this film, the hero, he is traveling in a rural bus and he's sleeping and gets up and feels like smoking. He takes out his cigarette, but there's no match. So he taps the guy in at the back and says, "Amigo, can you lend me a match?" So that guy gives him the match, but then looks at him and says, "Hey, your accent is different. Where are you from?" So this guy is a big crook. He looks at him and says, "Yo soy de la India. I am from India." He said, "India? What are you doing here in rural Colombia?" This guy says, "Yo soy embajador de la India. I am the ambassador of India." So the other guy, they laughs. He says, "What? Is it a joke? You say you're ambassador of India? What are you doing traveling in this bus with us?" And this crook says, "Yo soy embajador de la India incognito. I am here to understand, mix with people." So people buy the story. And when they reach the little town, they put him up in the lodge and have parties every day and has a great time spinning stories about India. Until one day, one of his other crook's accomplices, he comes and spills the beans. So he's caught. Now, if it happens in India, what would people have done, Indians have done? They would have beaten him up, lynched him, called him the police. What did the Colombians do? They said, "Hey, you took us all for a royal ride. Let's have a fiesta." Then there's a real life story. In December 2008, there was a huge strike in Buenos Aires airport. And 3-4 days, flights were not operating, some were operating, a huge strike. And the Argentines, you know their temperament. They went and broke the glasses, broke the counters, threw stones. It was a total mess. I went to see off my son. I used my diplomatic privilege to get in. I reached the lounge for Sao Paulo. So while there was chaos and anger and frustration and noise and damage all over the airport, in that lounge where the Brazilians were sitting, there were about 70, 80 of them. You know what they were doing? They were drinking, singing, and dancing. They had all missed their, they didn't have their flight. They were waiting for 3 hours flight for 2 days. But they were all singing and dancing and collecting money from everyone, buying whiskey from the duty-free shop. Now, this is the spirit of Latin Americans. Let me make one correction. The stories, I told you the first one, literary story and the filmy story, they were also real-life stories. The first story, literary story, of this 18-year-old boy who married 36-year-old, it is the real-life story of Mario Vargas Llosa himself, who at one time was a candidate to be a president of Peru. And the second one, the movie, Embajador de la India, it was also based on your real life story. So that is the magical realism. Now, I don't want to talk only about the fun part, the dance and music of Latin American spirit. They also have a serious spirit of innovation, entrepreneurship, and a spirit of the society to work collectively and to put their act together and achieve things. I'll just give you three examples. There's a chapter in this book called Agriculture Process Outsourcing, APO, like a BPO, KPO, by an Argentine Patel. This is a guy called Gustavo Grobaco Patel, whom you met. He's a dear friend of mine. He his company farms 270,000 hectares of land in Argentina, Brazil, Uruguay, Paraguay, and part of Bolivia. He doesn't own a single hectare of land. Everything is leased. He gives one-third of the produce to the owners. He doesn't own a single tractor, single harvester, any machine. Everything is outsourced. He doesn't pay the agronomists. Each agronomist takes care of 5,000 hectares of land, and they get a percentage of the production. And even the capital which he uses is not his. That's also outsourced. The funds they have invested in. So he has innovated this new practice of agriculture process outsourcing, connecting the owners of the land, the service providers, and including the commodity traders, everyone in a virtual chain, adding value to everyone, adding to production. And this is the new business model. And this is the one innovated in Argentina, and it has gone to other countries, including United States. Entrepreneurial spirit. There is a chapter in this book about a Brazilian called Cecilia Clelia. Now, this Cecilia was working in an Indian shop in London. And the Indian, the owner, he fell for the Brazilian. So she brought him to Sao Paulo. And they married, and they lived together. But she wanted to do some business with India. So she started the business of importing henna products from India, distributing to local market. It became successful. Then she started importing only the ingredients and made her own brand, her own products, and marketed in Brazil. It became successful. Then she started exporting to many countries, including India. She exports over $1 million of henna products with her brand. It's called Surya Henna, to India. And she's going beyond that. She wants to start a plant here in India to make henna products to export to other countries. That is the enterprising spirit. Now, about the collective spirit of putting the act together, I'll give you one example. In the 70s and 80s, India and Brazil were in the same level, same situation of oil imports. We were producing 70% and importing 30%. In the case of Brazil, it was the opposite. Then the Brazilians innovated. They went for this fuel ethanol program. Today, almost all the cars produced in Brazil, they run on flexi fuel engines. They have reduced the petrol consumption by 30% using this ethanol program. How did they do it? They did it by getting all the players together and reaching a consensus. The farmers, the farm lobbies, the producers of ethanol, distillers, the car companies, the oil companies, And today they are the global leader and pioneer in use of fuel ethanol, which has not only reduced their import of petrol, it is also a cleaner fuel. It's cleaner than the corn ethanol from United States and more effective. Well, we had also were talking about introducing 5% ethanol, but we've been talking and talking. Now, I talked about the Latin American spirit. Let me tell you something about the Latin America as a region, what I call as the new Latin America. Latin America has undergone a paradigm shift. It has undergone fundamental changes politically, economically, socially, and culturally. And I tell our people, the business people, don't read history books, throw them away. I tell them this Mexican ballad which says, Nume preguntas más, déjanos imaginar que no existe el pasado, que nos conocimos cuando encontramos, which means, don't ask me anymore. Let us imagine that the past did not exist. Let's imagine that we were born when we got to know each other. That is the new Latin America. Now, politically, in the past, the region was known for political instability and military dictatorship. And the region was in a turmoil because of vertical polarization between the left and the right, between the radicals and the conservatives, between the dictators and guerrillas. But now, in the last two decades, this gap is narrowing, and they are moving towards the consensus, towards the center, with pragmatic policies, pro-poor and pro-business, market-friendly and inclusive development. But in this, it is not 50-50, it is 60-40. Pro-poor is 60% and 40% is pro-business. Now, with this consensus policy, over 50 million Latin Americans have been brought out of poverty line. They have joined the middle class. So the middle class is growing, emerging stronger. And I believe this emerging stronger and bigger middle class is the insurance for political stability and maturity in the years to come. Now, this new growth model, development model, I call it as Brasilia consensus, as against Washington consensus. Washington consensus made Latin America lose a decade in the 80s. It's called the last decades. The Brasilia consensus has given rise to a growth decade in this decade. Now, the evidence that this is the dominant trend, this is the way Latin America is moving, although there are exceptions, glaring exceptions, is that, I'll give you two examples. In Uruguay, in 2005, someone called Mujica stood for election to presidentship. He was a guerrilla, he was in jail for 14 years, including 1 year in a deep well, dry well. When he stood for presidentship, so people thought, the business people, the right-wing media said, oh, this guerrilla is going to come and take revenge. He will not be suitable to run the country. And you know what he said? He said, I'm going to be like Lula. I'm going to follow the Brasilia consensus, moderate centrist policies. He was elected. Then there is this person called Ollanta Humala from Peru. First time when he stood for elections, he lost because he was like Chavez. Second time, he got Brazilian advisors who told him, follow this model. He promised to the Peruvians, I'll be like Lula. I will follow the Brasilia consensus. He has been elected. He is the president now. A word about the external policy of Latin America. You know, in the past, this internal polarization gave the opening for external interference. Monroe Doctrine, and Latin America was called as the backyard of some other country. No longer, because as the gap narrows, as there is, they are moving towards consensus, they give less opportunity for external interference. And the Latin Americans have smartly started building firewalls, which are called as the regional groups, Mercosur, Andean Community, SICA of Central America, UNASUR, now the latest one, CELAC. Now, these are all regional groups which have been formed not only for collective economic prosperity and collective stability, but also as a collective insurance for security. For example, you know the story of Noriega, who was picked up from the presidential palace in Panama and put in jail in US. They cannot do it to Chavez tomorrow because he's part of Mercosur. So this is the insurance he has got and the Mercosur has got. So I asked a Brazilian friend of mine, how is the state of relations between Brazil and United States? As usual, he told me a story. He said, there was a Texan guy who visited Copacabana and Ipanema and fell in love with the garota de Ipanema, the girl from Ipanema, married her and took her to Texas. And once he reached there, he called her, said, come, sit down. I'll explain to you the rules of our marriage. Three rules. Number one, I'm the boss. Number two, I will go out anytime I like, do anything I like, no questions. Number three, as and when I come back home, that is 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock at the night, the food should be ready, warm, on the table. So this Texan macho asked this Brazilian girl, yeah? You have any reaction? You have any comments, conditions? She said, no, nothing. I have just only one small comment to make. Oh, what's that? She tells him, you see the bedroom there? There will be sex in the bedroom every night at 10 o'clock, whether you are there or not. So this is how Latin Americans deal with the United States. A word about the economic stability. You know, in the olden days, you had IMF cases, Brazil, Argentina, many countries. They all used to go to the executive director of IMF, trembling, asking for rescue packages, and IMF used to put conditions. But now there is a role reversal. In December 2011, when Christine Lagarde went to Brasilia, she was the one who was trembling when she was meeting President Dilma, because she was asking for money from Brazil for rescuing Europe. And Dilma said, yes, we'll give the money, but two conditions. One, you must reform IMF. Two, you must tell the wretched Europeans that they must behave, they must be disciplined, they must exercise fiscal prudence. These were the words used by the other side to Latin America in the past. Now they are giving it back. Now, the reason why they are giving it back is because Latin America, the Latin American policymakers, are exercising fiscal discipline and prudence consistently in this decade. Just to give you two examples. The fiscal deficit in the case of Latin America in 2011 was 0.3%. In 2010, they had a primary surplus of 0.3%. In this decade, the deficit has been under 2%. In Europe, it is over 4%. In the case of UK and Spain, it's over 8%. In the case of United States, it is 8%. Let's take the case of debt. Debt as a percentage of GDP in the case of Latin America is 28%. In the case of Europe, it is 87%. In the case of United States, it's 100%. Now you tell me who is fiscally prudent and disciplined. This is the new scenario. In the olden days, Latin America had hyperinflation, 3,000%, even in 1989-90. In those days, there was a joke. You know, one can never say exactly the figure of Latin American inflation and Indian population. By the time you finish the sentence, both would have gone up. But now, the Latin American inflation has been in single digit in the last decade. In any case, much lower than in India. Hey, look at the growth rates. Latin America grew by 6% in 2010, 4.7% in 2011, and this year, 3.5% plus. Despite the global crisis, Latin American economic, the macroeconomic fundamentals have not only become stronger, the economies have become resilient and resistant to external shocks. That is why I bet on this new Latin America, which can sustain its political stability and economic growth in the decades to come. What does this new Latin America has to offer for us, India? I'll just give you only two examples. One is energy security, the other one is food security. We have been importing over 300,000 barrels of oil per day from Latin America, which is 10% of our imports. We are going to need more, and Latin America has the potential to produce more. Today, Brazil produces 2.5 million barrels per day. By 2020, they are going to produce 5 million barrels. Mexico, with this new government, are going to invest, do a bit of privatization, they are going to increase production. Colombia, which was producing only 500,000 barrels per day, is now producing 1 million barrels per day. So you have more production of oil in Latin America. Besides that, there is shale gas. You know the story of shale gas in the United States, which is a game changer. It brought down the price of gas from $16 to $2. Argentina has the third largest shale gas resource in the world after US and China. And they have an advantage. Unlike in US and China, where shale gas is in the inhabited places where there are people and cities, here it is in Patagonia. So without touching people, you can get everything. So Latin America can contribute oil, energy to our energy security, oil and natural shale gas. Now, food security. Now, while we are self-sufficient in rice and wheat and the staples, we have perennial shortage of edible oil. In 2000, we imported something like about 3 million tons of edible oil. This year, last season, we imported 9.5 million tons. By 2020, it's going to be about 15 million tons. Now, our capacity to increase production is limited. The demand is more. Now, we have been importing about $2 billion worth of soya oil and sunflower oil from Argentina. And we can get more. Brazil is producing, Paraguay is producing. So as we need more, they have the capacity to give us. Second, as and when monsoon hits us, when we have shortage, like we had shortage in 2008-09 of sugar we got from Brazil. In 2007-08, there was a bit of shortage of wheat we imported from Argentina. So as and when you need these kind of things, here there is a place. And lastly, pulses. We import about 3 million tons of pulses from Canada, Myanmar, and Australia, and Turkey. Now, our production of pulses hasn't significantly increased from the days of 1950. Now, Latin America, South America, is emerging as a new source where they can grow pulses and export to India. Our friend Gustavo Grover Patel has already sent his first shipment to India. Now, I say that this new Latin America has synergies and complementarities with India. I call this synergy as the synergy between Bindi and Bikini, spiritual energy and sensual energy. Now, in Brazil, they say the speech has to be like a bikini, short enough to arouse interest and a bit long enough to cover the areas of interest. I'm afraid my speech has been like a Malgudi Kanchipuram sari of 9 yards. I would like to thank Mr. Tarun Das and the Aspen Institute, and he said there would be question and answer session. I tell you, I am no longer a diplomat. I am an ex-diplomat, so I can talk to you frankly. You know, they say diplomats of people who think twice before saying nothing. I will not think twice to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ambassador, that was amazing tour from people to culture, to politics, to economics, and to India, Latin America. I want to take you back before I turn to the audience. When you joined the Foreign Service and you've written about, you know, how you came for your exam, and you thought you would probably never come back again, so you thought you might as well see the Taj Mahal, so you pushed off to Agra. But you were admitted, you got into the Foreign Service. Now, you're supposed to choose a language, a foreign language, when you join the Foreign Service. So which language did you choose? I think, would you take the mic? Did you choose Spanish or Portuguese at that time, or what? So I'm trying to go back to your roots here.
We don't choose. The ministry chooses for us.
Oh,
they
okay.
Choose Portuguese for me.
Oh, they choose Portuguese yes. For you. And then were you posted in Brazil at
yes.
that time?
I learned or Portuguese Portugal? In Portugal, and then I had the opportunity to practice in Brazil.
Okay, so your first posting was Portugal.
Yes.
And that's where you spent, what, 3 years there?
2 years.
2 years mm-hmm. there. And that helped you to learn the language and the culture and all that. And then, and that was which year?
That was 1979.
79. And you talked about going to Brazil in 96.
Yes.
So was that your first posting in Latin America?
Yes. Our ministry has a very interesting...
17 years after you
but I was
joined
lucky.
The Foreign Service.
I was lucky, at least I got posted. You know, some time back, they posted two guys, one to Brazil and the other to Tokyo. You can imagine, the Portuguese-speaking guy was posted to Tokyo, and the Japanese-speaking guy was posted to Brazil. Hardipuri.
Okay, okay. So that's the root of it. You started with your knowledge of Portuguese, but you really got involved in 96, as you said. You didn't visit that continent before that?
I had no idea.
You had no idea. So you put your foot in there in 96, and it's been 16 years of marriage and love affair and whatever, bikinis and everything. And are you didn't talk about India doing anything in Latin America, Indian investments, is that happening? You talked
yes,
about
because
the,
of,
you know, the companies from there doing something here. Is there something happening?
Yeah, because
the
of
other
time constraint, I didn't talk. But basically, our trade is $25 billion. We export $12 billion, we import $13 billion. Our exports are increasing at the rate of about 30%, and it can be increased more. We have an investment of about $10 billion across IT, BPO, and chemicals, pharmaceuticals.
10 million? Million?
10 billion.
Billion.
$10 billion.
Billion, okay.
And the most interesting thing is you have 24 Indian IT and BPO companies which are operating from Mexico to Chile, employing 20,000 Latin Americans. And they have a new interesting business model. In the olden days, when I used to talk about Latin America, our businessmen would say, oh, Latin America is too far. But now, these IT and BPO companies, they have made use of the so-called barrier of distance as an advantage. So what do they do? With these 20,000 guys in Latin America, they do 12 hours of business there, and then they pass them on to Indians to do the next 12 hours. It's perfect, making use of the time difference. And the other interesting thing is, they do not take people from here. They use local people, staff, but even managers. For example, Aegis, which is part of SR Group, they have 5,000 Argentines working for them. 5,000 in Argentina. Not a single Indian. Now, this I tell the Latin American, this is our contribution to their human resource development. Because these 5,000 people, they have an opportunity to upgrade their skills, not only in IT, but also in multicultural skills, dealing with the Indians and Americans and so on. So this is our contribution. Thanks.
You keep saying Latin America, it's a continent. It's a huge continent, many countries. All right, all the countries speak Spanish except one. But there must be variations, no? There must be different kinds of people, different cultures, no? I mean, we are 27 states, we are 27 countries. Every state is different from the other, you know?
In one of my speeches in Argentina, I said, you know, in India we talk 18 languages, so now you can understand, we cannot understand each other. But he told me, you know, in Argentina we speak only one language, still we don't understand each other.
But are they very similar people all over? I mean, when you gave your stories about, you know,
You have differences, you know. Mm-hmm. Mexicans are different from the Chileans and the Argentines, Uruguayans, Brazilians. They have their variations, and very interesting, yes. And even the accent and the language is different.
So you're a great one for giving examples. Give us two examples of differences.
You know, the Brazilians are the liveliest people, the happy-go-lucky people, and you know, full of fun, and you know, they don't think about tomorrow. And yes. But the most serious people, I call it the least Latino, are the Chileans. Now, the Chilean economy is the most efficient, most transparent, most well-managed economy in the whole of Latin America, and the people work seriously, and they mean what they say. There's the least corruption. For example, they have a single customs, a single uniform customs tariff of 6%. Whether you import aeroplanes or water bottles or whatever, it's only 6%. So, you know, there is no scope for manipulating and interpreting in other ways.
Okay, I think I should go to the audience now. Who would like to start? Questions, comments? Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Light on that.
Standard of corruption.
Well, we have competition with them.
Enlighten us, please.
You know, I say that what we have in India is retail corruption. There it is wholesale. I'll just give you one example. In India, despite all of our other things, we have managed to make railways as the most popular transportation, which is inexpensive. In Latin America, railways have been killed. The same British who built railways here, they built in Argentina, Brazil, Mexico, everywhere. But it was systematically killed by the car companies who bribed the politicians. Today, Sao Paulo to Brazil is just 400 kilometers, and you don't have a decent train to travel. Either you have to go by bus or you have to go by train. People like Lula, who came from Northeast to work in Sao Paulo, he had to take 2 days of bus to come there. So you can imagine the extent of corruption there.
Ambassador.
Yes, thank you very much. Vish, thank you for a very fascinating presentation, and thanks to the Aspen Institute and you, Tarun, for this very interesting conversation. I have a few sort of, you know, very brief questions, comments. One is, you said that when Gurudev visited Argentina, then he had this very happy relationship with this young lady, Victoria, and he wrote to her at great length. What was her response? You said she did organize this exhibition, but did she also write back to him? Was it reciprocated, the same sentiments? Let me sort of, you know. The other is, you mentioned that story about, you know, that marriage to last 2 years, it was factual. How long did the marriage actually last, if you can sort of, you know? The third is, you mentioned, you know, that there is 60% pro-poor, 40% pro-business. If you were to compare it with India, how would you rate the policies in India? How much pro-poor, how much pro-business? You know, for us to get an appreciation. Then Mercosur, you said it is working. Is it working well? I mean, would that be your assessment? Is it? Has it been able to bring down the tariff barriers, goods, services? And the last one would be, you know, you said the Brazilian economy is doing well. Now I know that my banker told me, sort of, you know, invest in the Brazil Infrastructure Fund, World Cup and Olympics, etc., etc. And we invested in ASEAN Fund and Brazil Fund. Brazil Fund is 20% down. ASEAN Fund is 30% up. So if the economy there was doing that well, you know, I'm a little doubtful as to how this goes. Thank you.
So you have five questions. I hope you can remember them.
First one about, she wrote equally impassioned letters calling him as dear Gurudev. And some of the letters are quite steamy. And they've all been documented in a book called In Your Blossoming Garden by Keteki Dyson, the Tagore scholar. And for her also, the visit was at a time of her transition. Her marriage broke, and she was looking around. So that was the time Tagore landed, so you can imagine. The second question was?
About the 2-year marriage, how long?
Oh, that lasted for about 4 years. And the third?
200%.
Yes. Now, 60-40 is in Latin America. Now, I leave it to Mr. Tarun Das to tell you, and anyway, you all know what is the percentage we use in India.
We skip India now.
Okay. The last question about Brazil.
Mercosur.
You tell me one union in the world which is functioning perfectly? No, not even marriages. Okay? Now, so it's all in relative terms. All the unions from European Union to NAFTA, SAARC, the ASEAN, everything has problems. It's natural. But the thing is, it has emerged as a force to deal with, Mercosur. They have problems, they have a lot of internal problems, but everyone is committed. Now, Argentina and Brazil at one time, they were nuclear rivals. Today, they have signed a joint agreement. They have even agreement to have joint defense forces. They completely buried their differences, like Germany and France. But of course, that doesn't mean Argentina will support Brazil for permanent membership. So the fundamentals are strong. The superstructure, they have problems. But that is the direction in which they are moving. And lastly, about Brazilian economy, see, in the olden days, they used to say, if Europe and United States catches cold, Brazil and Latin America would sneeze. See what happened in 1997 during the Asian crisis. Brazil got hit. Not because of anything they did wrong, because these funds which had invested in Asia, where they lost, to make up for the losses they pulled out suddenly from the funds they had in Brazil. So that's how Brazil went into a crisis. Later, in 1999, due to the Russian crisis, again they went. But this time, despite this great crisis in the United States and Europe, not a single bank or financial institution in Brazil went bust. They are growing. They are growing less. They have problems like we in India have. But the thing is, they are optimistic. They are going forward, not like Europe.
Dr. Karlekar.
Yeah, I have three questions too. First one is, following from what Mr. Das said, that Latin America is a huge country. You did talk about a rate of inflation, but I wanted to ask you that there are many countries, and that 6%, there must be poor countries also. Would you like to disaggregate some of the figures on inflation? Secondly, what are your views on BRICS? Brazil, Russia, India, China, the conglomerate. And third question is, you didn't mention the drug cartels. Would you like to say something on that?
Yeah. The first question is inflation. Yeah. You see, what I told you is the average. But the highest inflation is in Venezuela, which is 30%. And the highest inflation, the second highest is Argentina, 25%. Rest of the countries are in single digit. And this is the way. Inflation has been decisively tamed. But in Argentina and Venezuela, they are exception. That's a different story. Okay. The second question is?
BRICS,
yes. Yeah, that is the invention by Jim O'Neill, who has marketed it, which is good for us. It suits us. And Brazil is happy to be part of BRICS, and so also we, and we have formed this new alliance. But you know, it's not going to be a European Union, or you know, not a common market or customs union. But you know, we have similar agenda on many issues. And the last question,
drug cartel.
Drug cartel is a problem of United States, not of Latin America. Out of every $100 generated from drugs, from production to the retail, $85 stays in United States. $13 go to Paulo Escobar and the traffickers, and $2 goes to the producers. Now, drug is a demand-driven industry. If they were not paying $1 million for a kilo, who you think will produce in Bolivia or Peru or Colombia? No. It's a demand-driven one. So it has to be sorted out over there, not here. But now what they do is, in the olden days, they used to control and beat the Latin Americans using Cold War, saying that you are with us or against us. Now drug is used as the next lever of control to beat Bolivia. The Bolivians eat coca leaves like we do betel leaves. But the Americans say that, no, you cannot eat coca leaves because, you know, it's a danger for the world. No, it's an American problem. They have put a spin, they have made it as a Latin America problem. And they have made hundreds and thousands of people got killed in Colombia, and now they are doing it in Mexico.
Gentleman at the back, last row.
Good evening, Ambassador. I liked your spirit about the new Latin America, but the two countries that you probably didn't deal as much and who are perhaps not in this new league, Cuba and Venezuela, Chavez. How do you look at these two countries and their prospect in the future?
They are exceptions. Cuba is the legacy of the great leader. Everyone has respect for him, so I guess it will take its own time to change. They are changing slowly. But Venezuela is a dangerous exception. Chavez is taking the country in the opposite direction. I was telling you about the narrowing of the gap and consensus. He is taking to the opposite, the old era of Caudillo's strong man, and he is destroying not only the industry and business, the society. So they would need another generation for Venezuela to wake up and become normal. That is his contribution.
Long ago and far away, when I used to work in CII, you know, CII was run by women, and the men only used to run. So one of the women who used to run CII is Shubha Rajan, who you have seen in Latin America. Shubha, you wanted to come in.
Any comment, sir?
Well, I must tell you that she was the first one to visit Latin America from CII. And I took her to the samba school in Sao Paulo, and she danced like a Brazilian.
Okay, we never got that feedback.
No. Ambassador Viswanathan, I just wanted to ask you, what is the common Latin American's attitude towards India? Does he respect him? Does he trust him? Or is it still a faraway country with snakes and snake charmers and things like that?
Yeah. Firstly, I must say that there is a similarity which I didn't explain in the story of the Embajador de la India, the ambassador of India. The reason why this Colombian crook got away saying that he's an Indian ambassador is because of the skin color, what's called the cafe con leche, the coffee with milk color. So I always tell people that in India, coffee and milk are already pre-mixed.
But what's the image of India?
in Latin America, it has been mixing. You have the spectrum from pure white to the pure black and this one. Latin Americans in the past had a certain admiration for Indian culture, literature, Tagore, and they started practicing yoga, meditation, particularly the time of Ravi Shankar, Beatles, it became popular. Now, these yoga and meditation have become mainstream activities. They are not just for the fun. You find every street corner, whether it is Guatemala or Chile, you have yoga and meditation centers. People do it seriously, and they're all the local Latin Americans who do. So that has a certain image of India. Now, this respect and culture for Indian, the millennial Indian culture, has been reinforced by this new admiration for the Indian IT industry. They think that something is wrong with the Indian mind. The guys are so brilliant in IT and software. So, you know, there is an admiration. And then on top of it, now, with thanks to BRICS, now they see India as a very large market, a growing market, and it is attractive for them. And it is different from China. China, you know, they do $235 billion, we do $25 billion. They have given line of credit of $75 billion to Latin America, we have given $200 million. Now, despite this, the Latin Americans see India not as an alternative, but as I said, we look at Latin America for 10 to 15% of our oil, they look at India as a 10 to 15%. They don't want to keep all their eggs in one basket, China. So they want to diversify to the extent of 10 to 15%. They say, okay, on the way back from Shanghai, let's stop at Mumbai and see what the Indians have to offer.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Just on the last question, I mean, I think the point that you were making was exemplified in the early days by having Mexico had Octavio Paz as ambassador. Pablo Neruda came, so it was very much consistent. But I'd like to congratulate you first on your thing. I've worked in Latin America for the last 40 years off and on, and you captured a lot of it, which I could never articulate. But two things which struck, and I think are particularly relevant for India, which you have not, is for years, the big problem in Latin America was inequality. I mean, everybody talked about the Brazilian levels of inequality. They have somehow figured out a way, and even Venezuela that you were talking about was one of the actually more extreme. So they have figured something out, and where they didn't figure out, there have been the cordios have resumed. So I'm wondering what lessons can you draw for that for India? It's not clear cut. Why can't we do the same sort of thing? Like, why can't we have a Lula type person? Or if you, second, multiracialism versus very, you know, in most of Latin America, the indigenous people have been basically exterminated. I mean, they were exterminated before the independence. But in Brazil, it's a multiracial society, multi-ethnic society. Do you see different cultures because of that?
As I said, you know, they are more pro-poor. Like in Brazil, they have these Zero Hunger Project, which is done more effectively than in India. And even rightist governments like Mexico and Colombia, they do this kind of pro-poor policies, and more poor people are coming out of poverty line, joining the main, middle class. That is the trend. But the racial thing, let me clarify. While they had killed millions of native Indians, still there are 40 million native Indians across Latin America, of which 10 million live in Mexico. And today we have one country, Bolivia, which has got a native Indian who has been elected as the president. You know, and they call them as Indios. So when I met him in 2006, he hugged me and said, "Hermano, yo también indio. Brother, I am also Indian." Then there are blacks. Now, Brazil has the largest black population outside Africa, more than in United States. They got about 80 million plus. They have been talking about affirmative action in Brazil for the blacks. But it's been going on and on. But now I think they have reached a kind of quotas, given some ruling saying that you can give quotas and seats for blacks. But then how do you define blacks? That is difficult because of the spectrum. But it has not been an issue like in United States. There was no segregation and all. But it has been done very subtly. Like, you won't find the blacks in the cabinet of Brazil. Like earlier, Lula had one. It was Pele. He was the one. But now there's no black minister. You won't find many black parliamentarians. You won't find them in this one. But it's not an issue. People are not agitated about it. And socially, they are mobile.
Two last questions. Ravi Kaimal.
Two questions. One is about Embraer, the aircraft company. How is it that a business which needs very high standards of technical ability, safety, management, etc., which sort of runs counter to the cultural stereotype of Brazil, which you just sort of illustrated with many stories. And how is it they've been able to do it and we in India have been unable to? Second question is a story that I have heard, perhaps you can tell us whether it's true or not, that the South Americans working for Indian software and BPO companies are trained to talk in an Indian accent with American customers.
Now, Embraer, for your information, it was the Argentines who developed aircrafts ahead of the Brazilians. They had these fighter aircrafts called Pampa and all, much before, in the 1950s. But during the Brazilian military dictatorship, they chose certain areas in which to make global leaders. And one of them was Embraer. They started as a public sector company, and they got the engineers, and the Air Force was the driver of this one. And then they privatized it to the French Thompson, and they brought in with their technology. And so this is one of the areas where the Brazilians chose, okay, we'll be a leader in this, and they achieved it. Like I said, fuel ethanol. Similarly, there are in agribusiness, there are other areas. Like each country chooses some areas and that, and this is one of them. The other one, the Indian engineers, I must tell you the story. This, when a Uruguayan was selected to be the first TCS consultant to start operations in Uruguay and in the region, she quickly bought this book, How to Speak Hindi in 30 Days. He came and he talked to people in Mumbai in Hindi, and our guys didn't understand Hindi. They were Rama Dorai and... no, there's no need for accent. Actually, that's not correct, because you see, that's where this cultural complementarity comes in. A Latin American with tremendous self-esteem in himself, he talks equally with an Argentine, with an American or a European. Unlike in the case of India, where you know some people, you know, they still have that complex, and they are open and liberal, and you know. So this is used by the Indian companies. Like for example, there was some TCS contract somewhere in US, and our guys were negotiating, but you know, Indians have a particular mindset and the way of dealing with that. But then, to complement their team, they called this Uruguayan, come over, because this guy, he had a way of dealing with the Americans in the Latin American way, and that was useful.
Last question, Mr. Kohli.
Thank you. Thank you, Tarun. You mentioned about many IT companies going there. I know some of the small companies who went there. But typically, the model that they follow is just to have one single CEO, and rest of the management team is all local. Now, which is very unusual, because it would be normal to take a few key people from here. And I found this with the Havel guy who's taken over the Sylvania plant. My second question is, if one, there are huge opportunities. You know, they say we have a landmass, come and you can grow things here. But we find this big cultural difference. And other than marrying a local girl, if you could just want to do business there, how do you react to that, you know, in terms of local laws, acceptance of somebody coming from India and setting up a business? What would you comment on that?
Now, about your first question, I'll go back to this Uruguayan. This guy's name is Gabriel Rosman. I think there's an article about him in this. Now, this Gabriel Rosman, I was recruited by TCS as a consultant to start their operations in Uruguay. And he convinced TCS management that Uruguay is the center of universe and center of Latin America. People had no idea where Uruguay was. And he started the operations, became successful. Today they have about 1,000 people there. And he extended it to Argentina, Mercosur, South America. They made him as South American manager. And he was so successful, then they made him as regional manager up to Mexico, Latin America. Then he did well, and they made him as regional manager for Ibero-America, including Portugal and Spain. And he did well. Then they made him as vice president for emerging markets. He did well, and today,
He's sitting at the top table in Mumbai in TCS board as executive vice president for global delivery. So this is the value addition of Latin Americans to our IT companies. Now, you talk about culture, rules, and regulations. They're all the same, a bit like India and Latin America. Like people talk about this Jindal failure in Bolivia. And the world press says that, oh, it's because of the unpredictable, uncertain policies of Bolivia on mining that you know, this failed. I tell them, what about India? It's even more difficult. So I find that the Indian companies which do business in India, they find it is easier to do business in Latin America. They are relatively less complicated than here.
Thank you very much. It's been a fascinating time. You know, of all the things that you've said, you just said something a few minutes ago which struck a very deep chord in me. We had 200 years of colonial rule, and we came out of it with very low self-esteem. It took us a long time to get self-confidence and, you know, look the world in the eye. And actually, the IT sector and the IT industry helped us to look the world in the eye. I mean, especially in the area of business and economy and all that. We were all, you know, we'll always be 3% growth, you know. We were like that. We said Hindu rate of growth, eh chalega, kind of thing. But what you said just now, they have self-esteem. They have self-confidence. But they were also Spain, Portugal, ruled them, no?
No, there's a difference.
So what's the difference?
We were ruled by the English.
Yeah.
But there, who is ruling Latin America are the same guys, the Spanish and the Italian, yeah, the settlers, and they are the ones who are running the country. So there it is difference. Like America and Britain.
Okay.
So America chose independence, but they are the same people.
So they came out with having self-esteem, it was their country.
The only difference between United States and Latin America is in United States you say it was customer is king. And here in Latin America, the king was the customer.
Thank you very much. Let's give him a big hand.
Anybody wants tea?